Hey everybody, I'm Dr. Emmanuel Maria from the Department of Political Science and Public Administration, the Open University of Tanzania. Our theme today, our topic today is organizational communication. We have a number of themes that we will discuss. Meaning of communication, communication process, importance of communication in the organization, and barriers of communication. As we all know, communication is very important for an organization to achieve its goals. So, as somebody who admires or who wants to succeed in an organization, you need to understand this concept of communication. So let us listen attentively and follow this lecture. We all know that organizations set objectives. In order for these objectives to be shared within the organization, communication is very important. That is communication between employees and communication between different hierarchical levels within the same organization. The process of communication involves sending and receiving information, that is messages, through symbols, that is words, nonverbal cues, attitudes, and moods. So, simply stated, communication involves who says what, in which way, to whom, with what effect. Note that, or however, that sending and receiving a message is rarely a straightforward data exchange between, because of an ever-present perpetual screens. So it is not as simple as you may think. Communication involves a number of processes which in one way or another, sometimes you have problems with communication. So it's not as smooth as you might think. Communication process involves a sender and a receiver, and it operates in both directions. That means the sender and the receiver. The sender can be the receiver, and the receiver can also be the sender. Communication is not complete until the original sender knows that the receiver understands the message. So, if you don't know the receiver of information has received or has got the meaning of what you wanted to deliver, then communication has never taken place or is not complete. Encoding is the process by which the message is translated from an idea or thought into transmittable symbols. Transmission is the process through which the symbols that represent the message are sent to the receiver. So, here we are going through the communication process in an organizational setting. The medium is the channel or path through which the message is transmitted. Decoding is the process through which the receiver of the message interprets the message's meaning. So, that process of knowing what the message is called decoding. Feedback is the process in which the receiver returns a message to the sender that indicates the receipt of the message. So, when you send a message, the sender, the receiver, will give you feedback. And that feedback says whether the receiver has received the message, he or she understood the message. Without feedback then, there is no way of knowing whether the receiver has understood your message or has received your message. Hence, communication will have never taken place. So, there are different types of communication. You have interpersonal communication, which involves a process that is defined by at least four factors. Feelings about oneself, feeling about the other, feelings about the content of what is to be discussed, and the feelings about the subject being discussed. We also have verbal and non-verbal communications, which are the two major types of communication falling in a organizational communication process. So let us see, what is verbal communication? What does it entail? Verbal includes oral, written, and electronic forms of communication. Now, verbal communication includes eye movements, gestures, facial expressions, tone of voice, and the like. It can occur during face-to-face interaction or by telephone, radio, or television. Individuals combine verbal and non-verbal communication to create unique communication styles. The functions of organizational communication include information sharing, so you share information with your colleagues or between the boss and the subordinates in various departments of an organization. It's also, communication is important in giving feedback, integration of individuals within the organization, persuasion, emotion, and innovation. You cannot achieve this if there is no communication. Communication process helps share information with people both inside and outside the organization. The information includes the description of organizational missions, strategy, policies, and tasks. That's why you have communication managers, public relations officers, to share information about the organization within and outside the organization. Also, information communication helps description of organization mission go to organization members, stakeholders, and through advertising and other media to people outside the organization. Direction and feedback on task performance mainly goes to members of organization through communication. So communication is very important for an organization to achieve its stated objectives. We have many scholars who have discussed issues related to organizational communication. The most important scholar, or some of these, I will mention only a few. Weich and Kuntz state that the function of communication in the organization is to connect the employees of that organization in order to reach mutual goals. We have mutual goals. Each employee has got his goals or what he wants to achieve. However, we need to share objectives and goals within an organizational setting. It will only be possible through communication. Communication in the organization is important because of the company goals setting. It helps the organization to set goals. So, through meetings, you do that through communication. Also, it helps development of plans, which helps to realize organizational goals. Utilization of resources also, which are human, financial, fiscal, and the other form, of resources, can only be utilized through communication. So communication is very important. In fact, communication is almost everything in an organizational setting. Communication in organization represents a complex system of flow of information, orders, wishes, and references made out of two partially complementary systems. Formal communication networks and informal communication networks. This is according to Fox, 2001, page 41. Formal communication is systematic and informal process of information transmission in spoken and written form, planned in advance and adjusted with the needs of the organization. The same we refer Fox. While informal communication does not follow the line determined in advance, but there is an undisturbed communication between particular groups within the organization. So, communication, as I said, is important in any organization. Be small organization or big organization. Communication flow in the organization can develop into many different directions. It can be upward communication, downward communication and sideways communication. Upward communication, the one which goes up the official hierarchical order, from the lower to the higher levels, from lower levels of management to the higher level of management. Information goes from the subordinates to the superiors. Downward communication flows from the higher to the lower levels in the organization. It has characteristics for giving orders, broadening of ideas, and communicational knowledge. It takes up a lot of time, but it is most common problem with the loss of denying of information on the path through the chain of command. Very often there is misunderstanding of the direction, therefore a backward connection has to be established in order to confirm the transmission of correct information, of correct and full information. What does it mean? There should be a means to get feedback whether people are communicating properly within an organizational setting. With sideways communication, the term sometimes is horizontal and diagonal communication. Horizontal communication appears among people of the same status within a department or among different working units. For example, members of the department in a university, whereas the diagonal communication appears among people of different status who are not formally connected in the organization communication system. For example, somebody lower in an organization, we have sideways communication. The term, or some other scholars, Wage and Kuntz, term it horizontal and diagonal communication. Horizontal communication appears among people of the same status within a department or among different working units, whereas the diagonal communication appears among people of the different status who are not formally connected to the organizational system. So, as I said, communication is very important. However, communication can have different dynamics. We have communication networks in an organization. There are three forms of small groups networks: chain network, cycle network, and wheel network. The difference between networks are the basic features of each network. In a chain network of formal small groups, mainly follows the formal chain of command. So, chain network has these formal groups, but they follow a chain of command within an organization, which is formal. Where the second network has the leader as the central person of conducting all communication within the group. As opposed to chain and second network, wheel network is characterized by openness that enables the joint communication of all members of the group. If we compare the networks in small group having in mind certain criteria as speed, accuracy, leader emergence, and member satisfaction, we would conclude that in order to come to a conclusion, we have to wisely choose a particular form of the communication record depending on the aim we want to achieve. So, if you want to form networks within an organization, we need to be able to choose whether to go with circle network, wheel network, or any form of network, because it will depend with what we want to achieve within an organizational setting, or how we want to achieve organizational goals. So, communication can be formal or informal. Informal communication in the organization, in an American business culture, is known as grapevine. It's a secondary and a very complicated communication network that is based on personal contact and opposed to the system of formal communication does not follow a particular line settled in the advance. So, informal communication is not that formal communication whereby you communicate formally within, which follow certain channels within an organization. Since Grapevine is not a less important source of information, the manager should acknowledge also the informal communication system in the organization and use them for the welfare of the organization. Managers, superiors, should be able to tap into informal communication within the organization in order to achieve organizational goals, to get important information from employees, which will help them manage properly the organization. Informal communication reflects the employee's perception concerning the organization. It often carries or asks for information that management accidentally or deliberately has not formally disclosed. So sometimes you can be a manager and something going on within the organization you don't know, but if you are connected through informal channels, you will be able to tap and know what is happening. Managers need to take care of this type of communication because it is very important in an organization. People talking about, oh, so-and-so did that, so-and-so did that. Oh, you know, that manager is not performing well. You will get this information if you are connected in informal channels of an organization. Grapevine consists of three main features. Firstly, it is not controlled by the management. Secondly, most of the employees consider it more feasible and more reliable than official notification provided by the top management. And thirdly, it is mostly used for the self-interest of the people within it. So, it is very important for the management to take into this, because there are some information which are detrimental to an organization that you won't get them if you are not connected or a manager is not determined to get information from the informal channels or does not have good relationship with employees. Having said that, communication has also some barriers. As an executive of a particular organization, management of a particular organization, you must make sure that barriers of communication in the organization are reduced to minimal levels. One barrier of communication is the linguistic barrier. The language barrier is one of the main barriers that limit effective communication. Language is most commonly employed tool of communication. So, you find you have people from different ethnic, from different ethnicity, people who speak different languages. You need to make sure that you reduce that barrier by introducing common language to be used in an organization, or simplify by maybe translating various documents within the organization to enable people to communicate and overcome this barrier of language. We have also physiological barriers. There are various mental and physiological issues that may be barriers to effective communication. Some people have stage fear, speech disorders, and phobia, depression, etc. These are psychological. I'm sorry, I say psychological barriers. There are people who have all simply cannot speak in front of others because of phobia. Others, they simply fear. Others, they have certain type of disorders, so they need to be helped. Others have depression. So there should be a mechanism in an organization to help such people to communicate properly or to reduce their difficulties. Emotional barriers. The emotional IQ of a person determines the ease and comfort with which they can communicate. A person who is emotionally mature will be able to communicate effectively. On the other hand, people who let their emotions take over will face certain difficulties. Sometimes when people are angry, they might miscommunicate and then they are in trouble. So emotional barriers is also a problem which needs to be managed within an organizational setting. Physical barriers to communication. These are very common within an organization because of the distance, the size of the organization. They are the most obvious barriers to effective communication. These barriers are mostly easily removable, in principle at least. They include barriers like noise, closed doors, faulty equipment used for communication, closed cabins, etc. They need to be removed for an organization, for members of an organization to communicate properly. Having said that, let us quickly go through what we have discussed. We have discussed the concept of communication, the meaning of communication, the communication process, the importance of communication to an organization, and the barriers of communication. I hope this will help you to go and revisit the literature, read more about this concept of communication, and how it will help the organization achieve organizational goals. Thank you very much for listening. Have a nice day.